Good evening. This is the College of Complexes. And we've been going for what? About 65 years? And let's see. What else?
I heard we had a speaker tonight.
Yes, we do.
I knew
Mike
Flores, for some reason.
Who has often been our speaker, but in spite of the ad and the reader of this issue, this week's issue, the hordes that usually come just to hear Mike have not all arrived. interrupting his soup, I'm asking you to greet Mike Flores.
Yeah. How's it going, Mike?
Is this my time?
If you're ready to say it.
You're on.
No soup for you.
Welcome, no soup for me. Yeah.
He's late because of my own negligence in taping another event. That's why he's... It wasn't him, it was me.
What if they were late at Lexington and Concord?
What did the United States say? Oh, there's my dinner. Hello, dinner. Nice to see you.
Where's my soup?
No.
Thank you.
No eating.
That's why I love you.
Make sure your mouth has no food in it.
Okay, folks. I'm Mike Flores, and... First off, I should say that I first approached several different groups, including the Navy War College downtown, about doing this talk back in December, before there were any protests in the street, when I said that I want to do a talk about the coming collapse of Russia and how it will begin with the Ukraine, no one thought I was sane. They thought that was just crazy talk, because our official government policy has been that the last 6 years, rather than continue the Bush plan, which was to move the Ukraine towards the EU, we got it in our head that it would be much better if we make Russia feel secure by giving it weapons. In fact, we've not only been in arms deals with them over the last 6 years, we have given them hundreds of millions of dollars worth of weapons for free in the mistaken belief that a secure Russia wouldn't try to expand around the world. Now, how did I know that the events were going to happen? Am I psychic? Nope. Did it come to me in a dream? Nope. The way that I discovered that this was happening is that over the last 2 years, Russia has been staging the highest level of propaganda that I have ever seen in my life, and that we woefully are far behind on. For the last 2 years, they've been showing on their news channels fake demonstrations, fake attacks on Crimean Tatars, fake stories about the CIA sneaking into the Ukraine to overthrow the government. This has been going on for 2 years, and guess what? Our intel, our military, our politicians, our political parties were asleep at the wheel. Now keep in mind that every time Germany and Japan buys a weapon system, they have to get approval from us. We still occupy Japan and Germany. But with Russia's history, we have no problem, so we can give them free weapons. No reason to have any secondary thoughts. Now tonight, I would like to take us into the realm of possibilities, not predictions. Uncertainty, not always the, well, we must do something approach that plagues our thinking today. How did all the experts in the West so completely miss not just the Ukrainian response to rejoining Russia, but the situation in Russia today. To understand how Russia was missed, we begin with China. The years-long debate that our government has subjected us to on China, I suppose, begins with the idea that swept conservatives when Mao took over China. Who lost China? We as Americans are linear thinkers. We tend to see the world the way we learn strategy from chess. One side faces the other. There are prescribed rules of moving your pieces. May the best player win. We are playing chess in a world that is playing Go. Go is a popular Asian game. In chess, you face each other, you make certain prescribed moves. In Go, you can have multiple battlefields. You can come from behind, around the side, down under another playing field. It is a three-dimensional battleground, and that's what most of the world is playing while we fight to keep strategic thinking on the level of chess. Now, our first response isn't when we lose a country, as the expression goes. Our first response isn't, maybe we had an unachievable goal. Maybe what we wanted, we couldn't get. That our interests weren't Chinese. That democracy and Christianity were not indigenous to the people of China. That China wasn't ours to win. No, our first response is always, who lost it? Seeing the world this way, realm against realm, has not only deluded us into ignoring the world around us, but led directly to our current delusions on both Russia and China. Our first delusion with China begins with our belief that the future of China is that a single outcome prediction has some worth. It does not. The second delusion with China is that somehow, through giant military spending, we are capable of promoting or altering the premeditated or the predicated outcome. The proof that these are delusions are simple to find. The Ukraine and the Russian situation. No one saw it coming because we're all fixed on China. In 10 or 20 years, we're told, we're going to have to fight China. We're going to need destroyers. We're going to need a giant military. It'll be like World War II. These guys are tripping. China has given us the money used for the bailouts by buying our bonds. And then we turn around and openly threaten China, saying we're going to take the money they are giving us so that we're ready when the big fight comes in 10 or 20 years. We think cause and effect. We treasure repeatability. These beliefs are the easiest to be blinded by, and they are the easiest to manipulate. Everywhere we turned until 2 months ago was either rising China or doomed China. In the rising China debate, we hear that China's rapid growth will make it a world power that will rival the United States. The doomed China debate comes with rising unemployment and political unrest. Our intel agencies, just like us as Americans, filter the world, and China in particular, with biases that we bring to the table and try to force reality into. We had no reason to question Russia. It didn't fit into our biases on China. So for the last 6 years, no one even questioned the arms deals we had with Russia. Just a week before the Ukraine exploded in protests, John Kerry was defending arms deals and the jobs that they create. You know, whenever they promote arms deals, what they leave out is the cost of human life, the cost of firing, the cost of moving troops. They just say, oh, we just got this new ship and these new missiles, and they leave out all those other costs, which are far beyond any profit made. I would like to begin the question of Russia with, what does Putin think? What does Putin see in the world today? Putin sees, with the possibility of his dictatorship ending, the end of the Russia he has known his entire life. He sees a void, a darkness, from which only misery can result. He is not interested in allowing Russia to recreate itself. He's not interested in ending the Russia of old and having a new Russia. He is interested only in preserving a crumbling and aging status quo, hoping that the new blood of a generation of contractors and computer people will keep everything afloat. Moderate opposition, which has tried to express itself openly and legally, has met a Kremlin which rejects constitutional rights and freedoms. By turning differences of opinion into threats of revolution, they are pushing moderates into more radical responses. Perhaps at some point Putin could have engineered an understanding between the ruling elite and opposition in Russia, but he didn't. A peaceful exit of his political structure appears less and less possible as his actions actually accelerate the demise of the structure he is defending. By drawing out the death of his political structure and not allowing even differences of opinion, the path to bloodshed becomes a very real path, and it arrives much faster. To keep society from uniting against him, the Kremlin has elevated Muslims, gays, lesbians, ethnic groups. All are used to promote social hatred. If this policy works, Russia could very well tear itself apart. Never in Russian history have political participants ever renounced personal power or stepped down from positions of power in the case of electoral defeat. Obviously, Putin's opposition would have to make these prerequisites to dealing with Putin's government in an end of Russian history, new beginning scenario. Across the Russian sphere, the fears are expressed in Kazakhstan, Belarus, the Ukraine, and a violently collapsing Russia, which would hemorrhage across Central Europe. Perhaps if our State Department, intel, politicians, and military could stop worrying about China in 20 years, they could begin preparing opposition parties to convert to democratic rule as these countries rise up in resistance to the new Russia. Propping up doomed regimes with arms and money is clearly not the way to go. We made a big mistake the last 6 years. Let's take a look at the conditions in the Ukraine, because these conditions exist across the board in this region. And let's examine the language that is being used. John Kerry has stressed to the Russians the political correctness popular in our times. He has urged for justice, fairness, equality in the region, which mean absolutely nothing to Putin. One could easily make the argument that political correctness began with socialist Russia, but it was an export-only belief. No one in Russia believed that crap. In fact, now we know that there were riots in the 1950s and 60s in Russia on college campuses between African exchange students and white Communist Party members on the campus. We just weren't told about it. We were told they passed a law, an anti-hate law, so there's no more hate. Imagine their laughter as Kerry argues for freedom and justice to people who have known neither. The Ukraine is above the Black Sea. The first actions of Russia when they moved in militarily was to block the Ukrainian Navy. Why would they want to block the Ukrainian Navy? The Strait of Bosphorus lies between Europe and Asian Turkey, which leads to the Aegean Sea and the Mediterranean Sea. It's a warm water port. If Russia doesn't control this, they will have to go through the Baltic region, which likes them the same way that little kids like the measles, to get to the Pacific. It's all geopolitical for Russia. It's all about warm water ports. In fact, who in America has ever analyzed what happened in Afghanistan with Russia? I have never seen anyone ask, why did Russia go into Afghanistan? Because Pakistan was right next door, and because they have a warm water port, they were trying to get through Afghanistan to get into Pakistan and take the warm water port. They never got out of Afghanistan, as they found a quagmire, which they left for us to discover. We learned from WikiLeaks cables that American diplomats called the Ukrainian governments, the last two Ukrainian governments, kleptocracies. In 2012, Ernst & Young listed the Ukraine as the third most corrupt nation on earth, along with Colombia and Brazil. Every single action you engage in involving the state feeds on bribes. From driver's license and vehicle inspections, the police, the healthcare system, the courts, the schools, it just goes on and on and on. Guess what? They have Social Security in the Ukraine. If you're not willing to bribe the bureaucrats in charge, you won't get any Social Security. Nothing. And this is across the region. This is Russia. This is Poland. This is all those nations that left former Communist Party members in charge. A habit we got into at the end of World War II. At the end of World War II, we let the Nazis come back into power. We took 120 to put on trial at the Nuremberg trials, And all the other Nazis were allowed to go back into the political and bureaucratic offices they had. Imagine you're living in West Germany. You've been getting flyers throughout World War II that freedom was coming. You were going to be free. And you're sitting there in East Berlin and you can't vote. And you're in West Berlin and you go to make a complaint at the government office and there's all the Nazis that were there. I don't know why this country encourages people to leave those people in place, but in the case of Russia, it is a disaster. Students can buy a college entry, can get exam results, their doctorate and master's thesis for money. Government officials have been caught with fake university diplomas. Business licensing, taxation, and customs exact huge bribes every step of the way if you want to open a restaurant or even a dry cleaner's. Half of the economy in the Ukraine is now hidden in the black market, just like Russia, just like the other countries in that region. We should keep in mind that Russia has dealt with sanctions for decades. It presented to the world a modern progressive world when the reality was very different. Russia claimed all women were equal before we did, but all women were encouraged to do was have babies, and they were given a medal for each kid they had. Boy, that's a real breakthrough for women's lib. We were told Russia had ended racism. We were told that Russia had created an idyllic world. And of course, after the fall, we found out none of that was even remotely true. Party members took government jobs, and the bribery and black market began. The jobs became entitlements, passed on to the party members' kids. If you're a young person growing up in Russia, Ukraine, any of these countries, why in God's name would you stay? If you're not part of the right family, where are you going to go? What future do you have? You don't have any unless your family's in the party or had been and has passed the job on to you. A new rising class of the rich in Russia includes the mob, people in the fuel and computer-related industries. They have a cozy relationship with Putin. And like that, it's nearly impossible for startup companies to compete with them. You want to talk about cozy contracts between business and government, you'll find plenty in that region. Even before sanctions, Russia's economy is best described as struggling. The Kremlin's military actions hit the ruble and Russian stock market hard, even before any sanctions were put in place in Russia. But why should they care? They didn't care when it affected them from the 1930s to the fall of Russia. Why should they care if the people suffer? Russians claim they are helping to protect the Crimean Tatars, which are an ethnic group they kicked out of their land, so they ended up there. Russia could lose the international recognition it has developed with the U.S., EU, and West in general. As we saw when the Group of Eight meeting became the Group of Seven meeting, Russia could be prevented from joining the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, which will hurt the people. But it won't hurt the people who are making the bribes. And it won't hurt the people who are running the government. an isolated, imperialistic, motivated Russia crushing its own people with horrible economics is sadly not a new story. Putin could remove Russian troops from Crimea to ease tensions, save his economy, and show Russia has not renewed its past imperialism, but I don't see that happening. The history of Russia's leaders in the 20th century does not bode well for Russia today. When Iran was hit with runaway inflation and economic malaise, the Ayatollah refused to change his economic policies, famously stating that he hadn't staged a revolution to quibble over the price of melons. Iran didn't care if the people were suffering or not. The country collapsed into economic misery for the population. But the leaders still got food, and the people in the party position still got the bribes. Why does Russia want Crimea? From the location, they can launch limited military incursions into the Ukraine to see how far they can go to test us. They can create unrest in the Balkans, which are part of the EU and NATO. They can also prevent unrest in Central Europe aimed at it. So they have every reason to stay there and to keep taking more and more area. The big winner here is the pro-Russian bureaucracy, which right now has no president, and is getting billions and billions of dollars unchecked with no questions asked from both the United States and Russia. Because as we all know, if there's a problem, just throw money at it. Who cares how many billions? Who cares who gets the money? Who cares how corrupt the system is that's getting the money? Just throw money at it. That's got to help. Will Russia march through the Ukraine to liberate Transnistria? Now, you guys will like Transnistria. It's a little sliver right on the east side of the Ukraine that is an old Stalinist regime, about the size of Rhode Island or less. They broke away from Russia because they thought Russia was too liberal. And the only way to get to them is going to be through marching through eastern Ukraine to go to liberate them, which I believe is going to be the next step Russia does. Will Russia march through that area to liberate it? I think so. It is. Did the U.S. lose the Ukraine? Certainly ending the Bush program of making the Ukraine part of the EU and instead making arms deals with Russia was ill-advised. But the moment we did, our intel failed to notice that Russian propaganda was making us the bad guy in the region. How come I could go on YouTube and find a news report with fake Crimean Tatars begging the Russians to come save them, and our intel didn't see it? It's on YouTube. Some of the most brilliant propaganda I've ever seen. And we are lagging behind. The CIA militarized and running a drone attack program neglected to notice what the Russian people were being told and shown about the region by their government-controlled media. Our over 20 intel agencies missed what was happening. Our State Department, not a clue. Our entire government missed what was happening as we concentrated our attention on a maybe war with China in 10 or 20 years. Russia played us and the world for suckers from the 1930s on in the propaganda war. They flooded America with propaganda during World War II, were able to stop films about Poland during the war. One night editor at the New York Times would quietly post pro-Stalin articles in the 1940s and 50s in the New York Times before he was caught after 15 years. Hell, one of Franklin Delano Roosevelt's speechwriters was a Russian spy. They are way better at this game than we are. The Russian people have had years of fake protest footage, fake interviews, fake incidents filmed and shown on television. In Russia, the average person thinks Putin has stopped a CIA coup and stopped us from sending troops into the area, which if Obama had thought of, he would have done already, but he didn't even know that area existed. I wish I could stand here tonight and tell you we have matched their propaganda, but we haven't. When CIA became militarized, it lost track of its mission. Once upon a time, shortwave radios and ham radios became the way to communicate to countries behind the Iron Curtain. Today, we have an open source for posting propaganda broadcasts for anyone to see. True news events and documentaries about what's happening. And it would infiltrate the entire world. It's called downloading. Groups like Demonoid, the Pirate Bay, are accessible in China, in Russia, in every country on Earth. Why aren't we producing product for them to download to at least find out what's going on? I don't know, but we're not. Instead, to appease Hollywood, we try to shut those sites down. The first entryway into any dictatorship that we have been given, we're trying to shut down instead of utilizing to spread the best propaganda, which would be just to tell people the truth about what's happening. You don't even have to make anything up. If you're going up against a government that's lying, all you have to do is tell the truth, and that's the best propaganda, and we're not doing it. Presenting to the Russian people the facts about what was going on in the region and Russian news in general would be a perfect counter to the Russian propaganda. So did we lose the Ukraine? Hold on. We could have, in addition, reached out to pro-democratic forces in the region and prepared them for a democratic changeover. But guess what? We didn't. So does all that combined mean we lost the Ukraine? No, the Ukraine isn't ours to lose. But these non-actions caused a crisis to occur in the sense that Russia was able to control the narrative, which they are currently doing. We are only reacting to what they do at this point. We have no plan. They have a plan, and they've been working on it for a couple of years. A difficult part of all this is that the level of response we have is even disagreed on by libertarians. You know, one of the things about libertarians is you always hear they all think the same way, they're all anarchists, they all read Ayn Rand, when in fact, Ayn Rand's group, the Objectivists, bar libertarians from joining, so attacking libertarians for Ayn Rand doesn't make any sense. They also disagree on abortion, they disagree on every issue, and Ron and Rand Paul do not agree on this issue. Rand Paul called for flooding the oil market with cheap oil to punish Russia, while Ron Paul stated that UN international law had not been broken, so no response was necessary. But both said we should not be sending billions to the broke, corrupt Ukraine with no strings attached, and we shouldn't be talking about sending in troops. So did President Obama lose the Ukraine? Imagine you were alive on December 7th, 1941. Japan has bombed Pearl Harbor, and the nation is angry. President Roosevelt calls the attack one that will live in infamy, and he goes to the Congress to declare war on Thailand. Would that have made any sense? It would have made no sense, would it? There are some pages still classified from the report on 911. The New York Times has stated they believe those pages state that Pakistani intel not only created and controlled the Taliban, they organized the horrific, bloody attack in Mumbai, India, killing many innocent people, and trained the Saudis who flew into the buildings on 911. And they also happened to protect Osama bin Laden from us for years, while taking billions from us every month. Not only that, but they are punishing the man who helped capture Osama bin Laden for us and now have him in prison. So what do we do to Pakistan for obviously being the country we should have gone to war with? Beats me. We're talking about Iran and Syria. We keep going further and further away from the country we know was involved. I myself tracked down through the international press the source for the stories we've heard the last 5 years that Osama bin Laden was long dead and was killed at Tora Bora. Guess who the source was? I found a small newspaper which was picked up by other press, which made it into the left-wing press that ended up becoming a major story over the last several years that Osama bin Laden was dead, came from an unnamed Pakistani intel source. That's how much they covered it up. Pakistan intel has been awfully busy. Now, I should point out here that one of my fears is that there will be a secret deal made between Putin and Obama. Obama will say, if you move the troops into the Ukraine to go save this little Stalin sliver on the side of the country, we'll speak out openly, but we won't do anything. And you do the same when we invade Iran. That is a very real possibility. On the surface, President Obama didn't lose what he completely ignored. Also keep in mind, Eisenhower didn't stop the invasion of Hungary. JFK didn't stop the Berlin Wall. LBJ didn't stop Czechoslovakia. But like I said, this has given Putin a way to negotiate expanding what he's doing and allow the U.S. to attack Iran. Let's hope not, but it's a possibility. For reasons I have spent a lifetime trying to understand, our government and their age-old obsession with the yellow peril when it comes to Asia, and the complete and total ignorance of the entire region of what we call Asia. What is it that allows them to take bailout money from China and then want to spend the money on weapons to fight China? In 10 or 20 years, are they nuts? How do they miss the Ukraine and Russia? Can targeted sanctions hurt a country that already has 25% of its economy going out of the country? 25% of the economy in both the Ukraine, Russia, and I'm sure down the line, it's not even in those countries. They hide it in private banks in Asia. Now, can anything Putin does stop the young from leaving Russia, Poland, the Ukraine, every nation that is now in fear of Russia? The answer is no. Even if Russia stopped the young from leaving, that would only make the young angrier and the demise would come sooner. Will Russia's blame game, blaming minorities, Jews, Freemasons, the Muslims, the Illuminati, every tired, boring 18th century conspiracy theory you can think of, keep it afloat? If the cost is more terrorists, more ethnic strife, more open hatred is going to create a backlash, and it's a whip crack we're going to feel here. Creating more Muslim terrorists is something that's going to hurt the entire West. I want to note that Russian skinhead biker gangs, when did this start? Were in the initial incursion into Crimea. How did Putin become aligned with pro-Hitler groups? We appear to have done the exact same thing in the Ukraine out of ignorance. But Putin, he's not ignorant that these groups can travel freely with Russian special ops. Raises alarms that we had no idea who these uniformed and trained people were that were invading the Ukraine is disturbing. For at least 2 years in the press and media in Russia, the Russian people were prepared for the incident with the Ukraine. News stories, fake demonstrations, stories about the U.S. encouraging a coup, even a CIA invasion of the Crimea are the stories Russians believe. This while our intel slept. Still doing stupid old radio broadcasts and ham radio broadcasts instead of downloading and putting up a YouTube channel. The truth, not fake stories, is the best response to deliberate government falsification. And our initial urge to quick do something, whether it works or not, we immediately began pouring billions into this corrupt government. But at least we can say we did something lame. We have ignored the region, thrown money at it, and tried to make ourselves part of the political climate. We have bumbled, stumbled, and crumbled. In lieu of no foreign policy, we are reduced to reactions to headlines, rushing in, throwing money around, and considering troop involvement. After all, who is NATO but us? When they say we're going to send in NATO, if we're not there, the NATO guys stand around and go, gee, that's too bad they shot and killed those 50 people. That's what NATO is, okay? Unless we're there, nothing's going to stop. That Russia could put together a militia with uniforms and training without our knowledge raises questions about what our over 20 intel agencies are doing or not doing. That no one noticed the propaganda war that blamed us for the Ukraine is also disturbing. The propagandists from Russia have always been able to run circles around us. The book, The Sword and the Shield, which is from KGB files, states that the KGB paid Mark Lane to write Rush to Judgment, the first JFK conspiracy book, and used Soviet scientists to create a believable magic bullet theory, which they then attack in the book. In Sword and the Shield, we discover that the KGB, using Russian scientists, created over 200 JFK conspiracy theories. The two men in charge, named in the book, got their order of linen for creating all that propaganda. The power of Russian propaganda is that after gullible Americans discover the facts, discover that the Zapruder film was re-edited by the KGB, as was the motorcycle cop's audio recording, guess what? They still think there must be something to the story. That's how powerful Russian propaganda is, that decades later, even knowing the names of the men who created all those stories, we still want to believe. Even intellectuals fall for their propaganda. Frank Zappa believed the stories that AIDS was created in a military lab that won the two JFK spinners another order of Lenin. But there was enough scientific jargon in the theory to fool Frank Zappa. I would say that today, Russia is one step away from being able to fake political speeches, presidential speeches, create with computers fake attacks that look real. A broad, new, and persuasive form of propaganda. Meanwhile, we have been unable to come up with a propaganda war plan after a dozen years of stumbling around the Mideast. Clearly, the CIA needs an audio-visual department like we had in eighth grade. A fake American president shown giving the orders to attack the Ukraine to the Russian people could justify any Russian response. We don't even know how to play that game. Russian scientists working with propagandists to create conspiracy theories could impact us for decades to come. So is this a new Cold War? No, mainly because the key reason for our response to the Soviet Union back then was it had declared war on us. The Soviet Union had vowed to destroy all capitalist countries on Earth so that their state could wither away and they could enter into communism. That was a bold threat to wipe out the West. They don't have that threat now. Now they're just trying to hold on to the game. What is the nature of Russian imperialism? Russian imperialism differs from British imperialism in that Russians try to squash anyone different and make their colonies just like Russia, as did the Germans, as did the French. The British didn't try to remake the nations they occupied into their image the way that the Russians do, out of habit. They just do it. That Russian arrogance does not bode well for the future of Russia. We have already seen the rage of those occupied, and many of the people in these regions have risen up before. Putin is trying to stop the clock. Ultimately, he will fail. As for the U.S., a general yesterday, this lets you know, and this is the first time I've done a talk on an ongoing news story. A general just yesterday stated that he was concerned about Russia and the Ukraine because of the effect it might have on China. Well, at least we know we haven't learned a goddamn thing. We are in a new era in which wars can be fought without firing a shot. Unfortunately, there is no rule book for cyber warfare as there is for general war. So we end up with the agencies collecting millions of emails that they can never read for no other reason than they can. Instead of planning for huge World War II naval battles with China in 20 years, which I think is nuts, maybe we need to concentrate on creating a rule book for cyber warfare, or is that just me? I submit also we should be preparing for what is going to happen as Russia collapses. What should be our response? I'm afraid we're not doing that. I think keeping your troops and money here makes more sense than going down the rabbit hole of pouring arms and money into openly corrupt governments. And can we please think of Asia as something beyond Korea, Japan, and China? There's a lot more to Asia than that, and Americans don't care. Top to bottom, it isn't just the intel agencies that don't care. Most of my friends have no idea where the Ukraine is. I mean, it's just a fact. Just 2 days ago, our intel stated that they thought Russia would move on the eastern Ukraine within 5 days. So this is the hump day. Oh well, better late for our intel than never. Actually, I don't believe that they're going to attack within 2 days. But this will be on video, so we'll be able to see. But our intel is trying to look like it can actually do something, when the facts are it has not been able to in over a decade. What we have in our favor in all this is that the bigger a nation gets, the slower it gets. That those who make the rules are inviting those who don't to break them. What the Russians are trying to do in stopping the clock can't be done. It will eventually fall apart. It's not going to be good. Who knows where all the weapons will go or anything else, but it'll be a lot worse falling apart than what happened last time. Now, this is a live situation. That means things are happening every day on this issue. Back in December, like I said, no one cared to hear this talk. They thought I was crazy to think that Russia was collapsing and the first sign would be in the Ukraine. I do not see what they have done in the Ukraine as being strong. I see it as being weak. And ultimately, all of this is going to collapse on them. Now, you know, in physics, if you're going down Lakeshore Drive at 100 or more miles an hour, let's say you're on a motorcycle, you go by a car, when you look at the car, even though you're going really fast, the people in the car are moving like this, almost like a strobe light, almost in slow motion. Because the faster you go, the slower you get. The bigger you get, the harder it is to move and change and be fluid. As Russia tries to keep itself going as an imperialist power by snatching up these countries, they are creating their own doom. So, I'm interested to hear your rebuttals, your comments, and your questions, and I want to thank you guys for being the one group, before anything happened, that allowed me to come and give this talk. Thank you.
We should come up with a speaker policy.
Oh, we have two errors.
Yeah, and I certainly wasn't first. They were way before me.
I wasn't.
It's not so much a question.
Let's wait for Brown's official announcement. Well,
yeah. Let's see. Who has the first question? Pat Butler.
Okay. Mike, it's a given that, you know, Russia and other parts of Eastern Europe have been cesspools of corruption and tyranny since the days of the boyars, never mind the Romanov czars. This is nothing new. On the other hand, what business, what do we gain? What does the United States and our allies, our Western allies, gain by getting ourselves involved in something which is essentially a dysfunctional family argument? And, you know, why should we have to pay the price in American lives, in American money, you know, in American disunity, because you can be sure anytime we stick our nose in a country that is not in our direct interest, you're going to have people in the streets protesting. What are we supposed to do? Would you have us send in troops? If so, how many? Where would you land them? How would you supply them? And what would we gain? Most importantly, what would we gain by getting involved in this sort of thing?
Well, I hope we don't stumble into that situation, but because we don't have a plan, because we don't have a policy, because we're just reacting to what the Russians do, we could stumble into sending in troops. There, we could send troops into Poland. During the Cold War, the plan for Poland was that Russia was going to draw our NATO troops into Poland and then level Poland with atomic weapons. That was their plan. They didn't care for the Polish people at all. They were just going to drop atomic bombs on the country and kill everybody. And that was their plan. I would say our best, what I think we should do has to do with way stronger sanctions, but we should avoid sending a leaderless, corrupt government billions of dollars, and we have no reason to send troops in. But do I think that's what we'll do? We don't have a plan. We're like a ball in a pinball machine being knocked around by forces we don't even understand. I hope we don't stumble into war, but we have before. We haven't been logical before. What the heck are we doing not doing anything to Pakistan for protecting the people who attacked us on 9/11? When you go into a war and you don't have a plan of action, you don't have a plan of victory, aren't you doomed? Aren't you doomed? We're stuck in all these quasi-wars while our leaders look for the new holy grail, which is a new desert storm. They want to find a new desert storm that they can wrap themselves up in glory. But you know what? There's a big difference between what happened under Bush 1 and what happened in Iraq the last time, in Afghanistan. What we're seeing is, sadly, until we get our bearings, we're just being knocked around, and that's a bad place to be in any fight. You as an Irishman know that.
I know that, Mike.
Mike, you've talked an awful lot about propaganda. I was wondering, when I look at my television, there's something called RT, Russian Television. Do you know who... What's behind that outfit?
By the way, I do follow that on YouTube, and I it seems that the Russian news broadcasts for the rest of the world are far more open than the Russian news broadcasts for the Russian people. And for example, while they were watching film of Crimean Tartars begging for the Russians to come save them from the brutal Ukrainian oppression, we were seeing stories that had nothing to do with that. The Russians are really good at playing this game. As for now, I follow a lot of Russian press.
But who's behind the Russian television, that RT, that...
That I couldn't tell you, but I do know that the editor of like their leading newspaper in Moscow quit like 2 weeks ago because he got tired of being told what to print. But they have, the propaganda that we see is propaganda aimed at us. The propaganda they create for Russians is totally different, and they're creating that news. Now, when we were faced with that in Japan during World War II, when the Japanese government was hiding its losses, we didn't have to lie. We just dropped flyers on people telling the truth. And the Japanese people began to believe us. That's part of the reason you didn't see the resistance to us going into Japan that you did in Germany. In Germany, you had the werewolves who were, we've only recently found out how big they were, and had actually slain mayors and leading people in Germany after the war. They were pro-Nazis, called the werewolves. They didn't have that in Japan, because the Japanese people trusted us because we were telling them the truth when their government was lying. That's where we should start. I think that's where we should start. Let's start telling the Russian people what's really going on.
Give any credibility at all to this election or this referendum that they had to succeed?
No, because Russia always went into countries on the request of someone. I mean, while there were thousands of people in the streets of Czechoslovakia, one politician got up and said, "We need the Russians," and they moved the tanks in. So there's always somebody saying, "We need the Russians," and they're usually someone who's on the graft, who doesn't want to see that money go away, who wants to make sure his son can work, even if no other son can on the block. And that's really what it comes down to, and it's brutal. And if I was a young person living in any of those countries, I'd get the hell out of there, to be honest with you. I'd get out of there.
All right, Jim?
You know, you talk about a rematch here between the Russians and the United States. What's going to be the ultimate outcome of that rematch? Is it going to be that Russia collapses as a power and we perhaps can see the dawning of a new American age?
At this point, what's preventing a new American age is that, for example, look at Chicago. We owe hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars in pensions that were either underfunded or the money was stolen to try to get us the Olympics. So what do we do? Do we start cutting the size of government, cutting the regulations, or do we raise property taxes? Do we hit renters with money to make up the difference? Until we start cutting the size of government, we're not going to have a new age.
All right, Charlie Spada.
Yeah, Mike, I heard you say about 25 times about Russia going in, and I wanted to look. I looked up what Russia was going into in this Ukraine, and I looked up. The first thing I got was a guy doing one of them, a picture of a guy doing that Russian dance they do. And then the next was some old ladies going to a Greek Orthodox church. And then, because of railroading, I looked this up, and the Ukraine system is entirely on the 5-foot metric gauge of the Soviet, of Russia, and they use the same couplers in their railroads as Russia, instead of the American or European type. So I'm wondering, are they going in? What do you mean going in? They're already in.
Well, by going in, I meant the troops being sent in.
But that's one culture. That's one country they've been locked.
I feel that they are going to go through eastern Ukraine to go after that little Stalinist state.
Oh, for what?
Well, we'll see. You know, I mean, I hope you're right. I hope they stop where they are.
Russia needs, what do they need?
They need warm water ports, and the Baltic area would be a prime terrorist reaction spot.
To fight who?
Yeah, a couple. Why can't the Russians use Novorossiysk, which is up the coast from Sochi, as a military port? Why is Sevastopol so important? And secondly, isn't Putin saying we're going in to rescue these ethnic Russians in this other country analogous to Hitler going into the Sudetenland in World War II?
You know, that second part of your question, that was the first thing that I thought of when I saw that. The differences are that Hitler had his news say on the news that the Germans were being mistreated and they had to go. They can now stage all that. They can film that and show it on the news in Russia. And that's what they've been doing the last 2 years about the Ukraine. I think they're on a much higher level of propaganda than we are. They could show computer-generated footage of the President of the United States saying we are overthrowing the government in the Ukraine, and there'd be no reason for any Russian person to question it. That's how good it is. Now, what was your first question about using another warm water?
Novorossiysk is another Black Sea port up the coast from Sochi.
I think what
in Russia,
in their mind, Putin, or it isn't their mind. I should change that. In Putin's mind, I think he sees the expanding, taking back of Russian territory, spreading the trade between those countries will keep his country afloat as it did for years before. I just don't think it's going to work this time because people have already gone into the streets. People have already climbed on the Berlin Wall. People have already cheered the fall. So they already know what to do. I think our big mistake was that we didn't try to approach them at the demonstration level. It's the same mistake we made in the Middle East. It's the same mistake that we made with Arab Spring when hundreds of thousands of people were calling us in Syria, in that whole area, saying we need democracy. We need to know how to set up political parties. We need your help. Our State Department and President did nothing. Absolutely nothing. That's horrible and doesn't bode well for the future.
Okay, Jim Bolger.
Oh, you know, as you can see, though, I'm just gonna. What will happen after the Soviet Union collapses, specifically? What's going to happen to that country, and what will happen to America as a result of it?
Well, the steps leading up to the collapse of Russia, as we look into this abyss, and this is possibilities.
Okay.
I'm not prophesizing. I think what happened first is a general unraveling, just like we saw before when people were leaving the Soviet Union.
I mean, like in 1993, correct?
Except this time, I think it's permanent, and that there are going to be countries that are in economic collapse once the real economy emerges. I think you're in trouble when you have political parties that won't leave when they're voted out. That's a big problem. That's going to lead to violence. I think when you say that moderates are revolutionaries and you treat them and torture them like they are, that's going to cause problems. That's going to radicalize people. I think the way they react to Muslims makes the way the KKK reacted to blacks look humane. The way they treat the Muslim population, you're pretty much guaranteed we're going to have terrorists coming here to hit us that have been trained in those areas. It's not going to be good when Russia starts to fall apart. Hopefully, will have some people quit thinking about this war with China in 20 years and start thinking about what we need to do to reach out to the people in those areas and what we need to do with Russia as it starts to unravel. But right now, there isn't one think tank in America working on this. That's pretty bad.
I just found about six of them on the web right now.
Oh, I can't be.
Which groups?
One of them happens to be a group called Stratfor.
Oh yeah, Stratfor. Their WikiLeaks is always breaking into their site. Mm-hmm. I bet you that report is within the last month.
A lot of it's been in the last 2 years.
Yeah.
Anyway, enough said. Thank you.
I'm sorry. Pat, and then Charlie.
And somebody over here, too.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
All right. Pat? Mike, getting back to some of your earlier comments, you were, first off, let me preface it as if I must. I don't like Nazis any more than the next guy, but...
They had great uniforms.
No.
I was kidding.
After World War II, when the Allies came into Germany, and they had to reestablish some sort of government.
You have a chance, can I get
they could have done one of two things. They could have put American and British and French soldiers in charge of running the place, and they would have known nothing about running a police department in Germany or a water and sewer department in Austria.
Or any of the
Krupp companies. After 12 years of Nazi rule, weren't these Nazi functionaries the only ones who knew how to run a local government in the Third Reich?
It's a mixed answer there. For example, the Krupp factories, Krupp was put into prison for using slave labor, but they took him out every day because no one could figure out how to run his company. And of course, there's the famous story of American Budweiser at the end of World War II going to buy German Budweiser, and as they drove towards the German plant, they had put up the old World War II posters that said things like, repel the foreign barbarians, stop the Americans. So they were very hostile to the Americans coming in. And of course, we have Willy Brandt was the chancellor of Germany when Black September took the Jewish Olympics guys, executed them. Because they wanted Sirhan Sirhan freed, something that we don't tell Americans about. The man who shot Robert F. Kennedy, probably the first Middle East terrorist act that ever happened in America, but we don't acknowledge it. Brandt would later free the members of Black September that killed all those Jewish Olympians. So he was still kind of Nazi, if you want to use that phrase. I think what happened was, the scenario, the way I see it, was that after World War II, as we began to realize that Russia was not our ally, because the Democrats thought he was, FDR thought he was, they all loved Stalin. And the idea was, if you look at propaganda films that were made by our military to be shown to our soldiers, the propaganda during the war was the German people had been brainwashed, the German military had been forced to swear allegiance to Hitler, so we were going into crazy land. However, with the idea that we needed to have allies against Russia, the propaganda changes at the end of World War II. Oh, the German people were tricked. The German military was tricked. Only 120 people were put on trial at the Nuremberg trial. You look at the Nazi rallies, there's thousands of them, tens of thousands, but only 120 did anything wrong. Obviously, Israel disagrees because they're still going after Nazis all these years later. So they didn't buy that there were only 120 Nazis. When we put them back into power, it was because we wanted to have an alliance against Russia. It's the same reason we let so many Japanese war criminals walk free, because we wanted them still in to help ward off Russia. That is where the habit seems to have come from, of letting the people who had screwed over the country stay in power as long as they were no longer calling themselves communists. But you know what? What if nations have a personality the way that people do? What if once every 100 years, Germany is just going to announce that it knows how to make the world work the German way? What if the Russians were imperialist before the Tsar, before Lenin, before Stalin, and just that's what they do? That's a scary thought, but it's one that I don't have an answer for that, but it's a thought that I've been thinking about the last few weeks. What if there's just a certain character, and it doesn't matter if they say they're killing Jews because the Jews run the world with the Masons, or they're killing Jews because they killed Jesus, or whatever excuse they have, they would still be killing Jews. That's a scary thing, but I wonder how much of Russian society is trapped in that imperialist mindset.
Charles.
Yeah, Mike, everything in the news I see, Russia's going into this country. Whatever happens, their guy's going to be in charge. They're going to go into Crimea, and they're going to go in that little stupid place on the west. They're going to kick out Mobil, or Chevron, Exxon, and Royal Dutch Shell out of the oil that they want, and NATO, the natural gas. And now you show up and you tell me, well, Russia's collapsing. It's gaining territory. It's not collapsing. I know you don't like commies, but can't you reconcile with the fact that they might be winning?
Expansion into other countries.
I mean, they're going to nullify
oppressing people in other countries. Doesn't work. It didn't work for the British. It didn't work for the Germans. It didn't work for the French. It didn't work for the Russians already once before. It's not going to work.
EU occupies the field of battle as the victor, right?
Well, we know from repercussions of everything from prices to unemployment. If your young people have nowhere to go, and you're losing your scientific minds, you're losing philosophers, you're losing artists, your country is in trouble, and Russia is losing all of that. And if I was living in Poland right about now, after being told, remember, we told the Ukraine, when they gave us their nuclear weapons, that for turning nuclear weapons over to us, we would defend them from attack. We just broke our promise. If I was South Korea, if I was Japan, if I was Poland, Czechoslovakia, I'd be scared right now, because there's nobody to back me up.
Yeah, they had a boot. Go on.
But if you lose your young, if you lose your creatives, if you lose the science, you don't believe that. If you lose the scientists, you lose your future, because that's your future.
All right, Andy, do you have a question?
I have a question.
Please. Oh, Mike Crowley.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Why should anybody in this country care? Let alone, why should our government try to do anything, no matter how you define that word? Why don't we do the old Pontius Pilate routine, just wash our hands of it? Whatever happens in Russia, happens in Russia. Whatever happens in Ukraine, happens in Ukraine. Crimea, Poland, Georgia, any of them.
Yeah, who cares?
Yeah. I agree.
Well, what? Not only who cares, but why should we? Why should we spend so much as $1 or get one person killed?
Because our response is always, begins with, we must do something. And
why?
Then, instead of saying, what is it we can do that will be effective, we go, throw money at it. So our first response is to throw money at the problem. Then we start threatening to use troops. Who knows why we do this? I don't approve of it.
I said, why should we do any of those things?
I don't think we should.
Oh, okay, I agree.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I don't think our government agrees.
You're right about that,
Andy,
too.
Andy has the next question.
Hi,
Andy.
I have a two-part question, basically. The first part is, you've been saying all throughout the speech, you gave us the impression that our intelligence agencies are playing catch-up, that they're, many of the world events, they're clueless. Is it your impression that the intelligence agencies didn't see 9/11 coming and that we were totally surprised that day?
Well, you know, there's now hearings that are going to be happening in Washington, D.C., because it turns out that from 1993 on, with the full knowledge of Bill Clinton, an FBI agent was right next to Osama bin Laden. Okay? I have no idea where this hearing's going to go. In fact, if you get any of my emails or you read the College of Complex's bulletin board, before the Ukraine invasion happened, I was sending out emails about this and saying, this is going to be a huge scandal. This is Watergate. And people were like, what are you talking about? An FBI agent is with Osama bin Laden and they didn't tell the CIA? They didn't tell military intel? They didn't give any of the reports to anyone? Outrageous.
Now, I caught you're saying we should have invaded Pakistan rather than Afghanistan? Or
I don't think Iraq or Afghanistan were the right places, as we now know. But the reason, of course, that I didn't state we haven't attacked Pakistan, even though they created the Taliban, even though they trained the people who flew into the buildings, even though they hid Osama bin Laden from us, even though they took billions of dollars from us, they have nukes. Why do we not want Iran to have nukes? Because Iran can stand up to us too. That little two-bit country can stand up to the United States, can be the country responsible for 9/11. Who have been in control of the Taliban this whole time?
You're talking about Pakistan.
And all we can do is give them more money? That's insane. And go, well, we're really mad about what Pakistan did to us on 9/11, so we're going to attack Iran. What?
And the time now is 5 minutes after 8. If we're going to have a rebuttal period, I think that we have to move to that now. I want to see how many people have comments.
Let's thank our speaker, Mike Flores.
Yeah. Good boy, Mike.
He's making sure that gets on the video. Thank you.
Good boy, Mike.
Mike gets a rebuttal period too, right? All right, how many? Your hands. 1, 2, 3. Three, four, five, six.
Go with
about. Well, in that case,
5 minutes apiece.
Why don't we begin with Pat Butler?
Five or six.
Pat.
5 minutes.
Yeah.
5 minutes.
Oh, give him six.
Yeah, we'll go six.
Give him six.
What the hell? Six. Half an hour.
Mike, this is a banner year, a banner day, a moment that should be etched in all of our memories. Mike, this is one time when you and I are substantially in agreement on something.
Okay, I'm going to change my view.
I mean, one of the questions that I did not get a chance to ask, but I will ask because it is worth a rebuttal.
Yeah, sure.
Why is it that the United States we're a country that does so many things well, has from almost the very beginning been lousy in the area of intelligence gathering. We almost lost the Revolutionary War because our spies were not nearly as efficient as the Crown's spies. The Civil War intelligence gathering was a joke. You had a woman, the Pearl Mesta of Washington, D.C. in the 1860s, who was conducting a spy nest. She'd invite all of the generals and all of the admirals and the congressmen and senators to her mansion in D.C. and then get them suitably lubricated and then get them to talk about all kinds of things, such as the details of the fortifications at Fredericksburg, that kind of thing. And finally, they caught her, they jailed her, they didn't hang her because she was a female and because the war was nearing its end. But the fact of the matter is, going back a few years ahead, in the 1890s, we had absolutely no idea what was really going on in Cuba and what was really going on in the Philippines, and so we did as we often do, we stumbled into the Spanish-American War. Fortunately, we happened to have picked a European power that was substantially weaker than we were, and we had this glorious Battle of Manila where our ships were ironclads, the Spanish ships were for the most part wooden, and our naval leaders were sufficiently concerned about preserving at least some lives. They edged the Spanish fleet closest to shore as possible before opening fire, because they wanted as many of these guys as possible to be able to jump off their ships once they were sinking and swim for shore. That was probably the one sensible thing that came out of that aspect of the Spanish-American War. We were totally unaware of the German operations in Mexico prior to our entry into World War I. We didn't know until the Zimmerman telegram was accidentally intercepted that the Germans were promising the Mexican government Texas, Arizona, and New Mexico if Mexico would enter the war on the side of the Central Powers. World War II, we all know about that. We should have known that there was a Japanese fleet in great strength moving toward Pearl Harbor with aircraft carriers, with fighter bombers. It doesn't take a graduate of the Staff and Command College to know that somebody is going to be attacked, and it's probably not going to be the Dutch in New Guinea.
Yeah, I know.
These are the kinds of things the United States, you know, they say some people in some countries are born with a lucky horseshoe up there, you know what. We must have a lucky charm buried somewhere, because by all the rules of the game, we should have gotten our tail whipped any number of times in the past. The one sensible thing they did during World War II, incidentally, was they informally drafted a lot of newspaper reporters, because newspaper reporters are very good at gathering information. They're also very good with words. They're also very good with languages, if necessary. So they took a lot of these guys, they literally pulled them out of their newsrooms, and a week later, they were in spy school learning how to become intelligence officers. And they were damn good at it. We have got to pay more attention to preventing disasters like 9/11. The idea that 30 intel agencies are operating independently, you, again, do not have to be a graduate of the Kellogg School of Management to know that that is idiotic. Whether in the military or in civilian life, that's just plain stupid. And how we can manage to be the big dog on the block that's supposed to have the answers, some would say the greatest empire since Rome, and we are screwing up left and right. Mike, sometimes you come off, you know, way off somewhere. Certainly your opinions on the Civil War and what should have been its outcome are a little bit interesting, to say the least. But I got to tell you, and I hate to admit it, Mike, because you and I have had a long-standing friendly rivalry, I got to admit, tonight, I think you really hit the nail on the head, and I'm worried because you're starting to sound very rational.
All right.
Who's next?
Who's next?
How was that a rebuttal?
I'll go.
You want to give a rebuttal?
I'll go.
All right.
That was a lecture on the Civil War.
All right.
Get up and give one yourself.
Next one
will be shot.
Okay. Well,
sure.
Call it. I'm going to do it right there.
I have to disagree with Mike as to a couple of things. I don't think our intel agencies are busted at all. I premised that on the remarks given by a gentleman by the name of Thomas P.M. Barnett and his book, The Pentagon's New Map, and the various lectures he's been delivering in the Pentagon and around the world for the last 20 years. And he talks about a new type of warfare. And he's recommended that the old type of warfare of state versus state, of nation versus nation, is no longer relevant. He's even saying that there's not going to be another major power war in the next 100 years because of something called nukes and what can happen. He does say, though, that the common type of warfare that we're going to be seeing is that of bankrupt states and us having to intervene to change those bankrupt states' governments. For example, in the Balkans, we had a lot of problems in the Balkans itself, but it was really with the intervention of the American and the European powers that eventually brought stabilization to that region. We screwed it up real big time in Iraq because we went in. We did not leave a lot of the Iraqis in power, but basically dismantled their entire civil service system and military. And in Afghanistan, we finally didn't have enough troops or enough of the native government infrastructure to counteract the Taliban. The thing is that we're spending more time now on this so-called networked warfare that's basically a strategic doctrine of the Pentagon as a result of globalization. Our enemies are not countries. They are individuals. They are groups. They are people in there. And more you see the military acting more like the police. And unlike Mike Flores saying that this is going to be the end of the Soviet Union or even Russia, there's a little another development that's come in. And that is the finishing, finally, of the Trans-Siberian Railroad and the development of trade and commerce. What you also don't know about the Central Asian Republics is that it's a vast steppe prairie. A railroad's going across it. Change the laws around a little bit, and you have exactly what happened in our 1830s with settlement and agriculture. It could be the next booming area. Where we don't have problems with the military is where if we keep relying on our fossil fuel economy, that's where I think we're going to be in trouble. But I have mentioned thorium-based reactors before as a cheap source of power, and that is what I believe is really going to change everything. Mike, you have a great lecture, but I don't think the American powers are dumb to this thing. I think it's more or less we're just not seeing it, and maybe there are a few visionary thinkers in the government itself. What we are good at is bringing governments down. What we're bad at is building nation states up. We can take down a country in days, and they think, oh wow, look at the great United States. We can't rebuild countries or bring them up. Remember, 18-year-old kids can kill away and knock down a government and take on an army, but it takes those people 25, 30, 40 years old with wives, kids, and families to rebuild and to draw a simple infrastructure and to get a country back on its feet. Right now, I have a feeling that we might be intervening in Syria, but we're a little gun-shy after what happened in Iraq and Afghanistan, and I don't blame them. But somebody's going to have to do it soon, or we're going to be really seeing some widespread devastation in that region.
Thank you, Jeff. Yeah, boy, Jeff. Our next rebutter is Mike Foley. Here.
Well, boy, Mike.
Thank you.
Okay. I'm Mike Foley. I haven't got much to say tonight. I don't have any prepared remarks or prepared statement. When I came here, and I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad I came to hear this lecture. I heard a lecture, I don't know, 3 or 4 weeks ago, also about the events going on in Ukraine. But something happened to me, I mentioned this before, it was last year around Labor Day. I went to a protest demonstration. That's when all the politicians in Washington, including President Obama, was yelling and screaming about poison gas in Syria. Somebody detonated poison gas in Syria, blah, blah, blah. We gotta bomb Syria, we gotta get rid of that guy, Bashar Assad. War criminal, crimes against humanity, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, it all blew over. But anyway, I went to an anti-don't invade Syria demonstration, and there was a woman there named Carol English. She wasn't a speaker, she just one of the women who was in the demonstration. Her name was Carol English. I've never seen her before, I've never seen her since. But if any of you know her, tell her that she was right. I told her she was right when I was talking to her. And I was surprised how quickly her thoughts came to fruition. She told me that she felt that the world was in the midst of World War III. She talked about it a little bit. Essentially, she said World Wars I and II, those two wars did not just happen to start all at once on one day. They were actually the result of events that have been going on for years. Things have been building up for years and years, and it resulted in World War I, same thing with World War II. She said, right now we're living through the part where events are happening in the world where things are building up, and it will result in worldwide conflagration. I told her I agreed with her. I thought she was right. We really are in the midst of World War III, and here it is. About 6 months later, it's just all this BS with Russia and Ukraine. I told her that I had never thought about being in the midst of World War III, but the way I described the world was, we are living through the end of the world. And I talked to her about it a little bit. She agreed with me. The world is heading for disaster one way or another. Worldwide disaster. Impoverishment and civil disorder worldwide, one way or another. Now we have this thing where Russia and Ukraine, and these doofus politicians in Washington are yelling, screaming, oh, a country shouldn't invade another country. Nobody mentions Iraq. Oh, a country shouldn't invade another country. Nobody mentions Afghanistan. Or the whole list that I talk about all the time. The United States is at war in at least 15 countries that I can name, and they're yelling and screaming about Russia invading Ukraine. A few weeks ago, it was reported that NATO troops will be accompanying Ukraine troops during military exercises this summer. I thought, oh, that's great. There's about 150,000 Russian troops ready to invade Ukraine, and now we're going to send American troops to Ukraine to conduct military exercises with Ukraine troops. What could go wrong? Well, with American soldiers in Ukraine ready to attack Russia and Russian soldiers in Russia ready to attack Ukraine, all anybody has to do is set up a couple of bombs. The CIA could set up some bombs and kill American soldiers and blame it on the Russians. The CIA could set up some bombs and kill Russian soldiers, blame it on the Americans. Blackwater could do something. Al-Qaeda, which is the Central Intelligence Agency Army, could do something. And don't mistake that we have been told for the last several years about the CIA involvement with Al-Qaeda. Don't forget, Osama bin Laden himself was an employee of the Central Intelligence Agency He was a government employee, just the same as Charlie is. He probably belonged to a government union. He probably had health care, paid vacation, and all that crap. That's Osama bin Laden himself. He was an employee of a government of the United States of America. So anyway, Blackwater is a CIA army, Al-Qaeda is a CIA army, and when you have American soldiers and Russian soldiers very close to each other, it's easy to start something and blame it on the other guys. Yeah. Somebody could detonate an atom bomb somewhere in the area. Anyway, this should be interesting one way or another. I think we should do what I said we should do. Do like Pontius Pilate, wash our hands of it, wash our hands of the whole thing. The world is heading for disaster. Our country is already in disaster. We owe gazillions of dollars. We're going to get buried by the gazillions of dollars we owe. We're headed for horrible inflation. We're going to be impoverished. We do have a nice standard of living, but that's only because we're living on borrowed money. We are heading for disaster. The world is heading for disaster. It doesn't really matter what happens in Russia or Ukraine. The course is set, and there's no way to change it. Because to try to avert the disaster would cause other very serious problems to be just as bad. Anyway, that's about all I got to say. Thank you.
I have a rebuttal.
Okay.
Mike has a sort of a tangential view of some of the historical events. For instance, when it comes to the Russians going to lay down a nuclear wasteland in Poland, that's not very far from the fears of Western Europe and the United States of the Russians advancing into Western Europe. They too were going to make a nuclear waste zone that the Russians couldn't cross and prevent the Russians from taking over Western Europe. When you're scared, when you see things going against you, you become very defensive and you use whatever kind of defense you think will be effective. I don't see that either the Russian oligarchs and Comrade Putin or the Ukrainians are all that worried. Yeah. For one thing, when the Russians take over in Crimea, the 60% of the population of Crimea are Russian-speaking. Yeah. And then there were the Tartars there, whom Stalin largely sent to Siberia, as he did the Chechens, because they were not loyal to the Stalinist regime that looked as did Jews and Muslims in Palestine to the Germans as rescuers, as those who might arm them against the hated British enemy. Yeah. Politics is a strange well, it makes business is business. People become rather cold-blooded about their relatives when it comes to business or politics. And I'm afraid that when it comes, for instance, Afghanistan, the Russians didn't do very well in Afghanistan, partly because the United States spent about $80 billion to arm bin Laden and the Taliban and others to defend Afghanistan against the Russians, who supported a regime there that was, to the Russians, progressive, and to other more liberal observers, maybe a little better than the monarchy they succeeded. But not much. The Pakistanis were, of course, very much interested in what went on in Afghanistan, because they expected that a lot of trade would come through Afghanistan, through the Khyber Pass and elsewhere, into Pakistan and from Pakistan to the Indian subcontinent and further to the Indian Ocean. And of course they have been playing politics in Afghanistan for many, many years. They succeeded the British in this concern. When it comes to the Ukraine itself, I'm not too sure that the Ukraine administratively is any different from the Soviet Union. It's unstable enough to seem a little more democratic, but that means that the elite in the Ukraine is not as solid, not as confirmed in its power as Moscow's. We'll hear from you in a moment, Viana. But all right, I'll wind up there. Next lucky pluck, who you've already spoken to some length, Pat.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Brown.
Oh boy, Brown.
Yeah.
Everyone gets a shot. You know that you've been here 50 times.
You're asking me out of the gallery. You've only been here. All right.
We'll give you a shot in a minute.
Yeah. Everyone can get them up. All right. Let's thank. Could I please, let's be able to thank our speaker. I'm going to be a little early. Anyway, can I? Yeah, you went all over the place. I think I'm going to get on the schedule myself, but my topic's going to be a little bit different. It's going to be the coming victory of Russia and the people. This is the opposite. It is what I advocate and what I think is going to happen. This is an unusual country. I'm not surprised that not everyone, including myself, is terribly knowledgeable about it. Its name, I believe, if you translate it, is Boundary Land. And it's one of these countries that's both east and west. And that conflict's been going on and is in progress right now. The choice is whether or not the Putin
and Russia is going to assert themselves, or are we going to turn this country over to the multinational corporations, big energy, Exxon, Royal Dutch Shell, or Chevron, and NATO? Yeah, this is the tug of war that's going on here. There's all kinds of politics here regarding energy and so forth. I'd like Putin to come in. I'm not really in favor of Bolsheviks, but in terms of the multinational corporations, they're going to come in and pick you clean, man. And they'll dry that place out and disappear. I can guarantee you, if you let free market capitalism go in there, they're gonna tear that country apart. They've had a lot of chaos since the 91, the independence thing. The countries, I mean, they've had leaders and one leader after another. They kicked one guy out and then brought him back, amazingly. It's just been a chaotic situation. There's even one of these jokes, and it's common, I guess you could plug in any country. If you took four Ukrainians and put them in a basement and closed the door and came back a couple months later and let them out, you'd have five political parties. It's that kind of place. They've had some problems here. There's been some promises made by the West. But now it's kind of thing, which side were they going to go? To let these multinational corporations come in there and make a lot of money and probably destroy the country. They've had some problems. I mean, this is where Chernobyl was. So it hasn't been steady, and like some of the other countries, doing quite well on their own. And the Ukraine, they just haven't found their mark yet. I don't know what any of this intel stuff has to do with anything. It's pretty easy to figure out that they need some time. It's understandable. They don't have the qualities. Like, Lithuania was nothing to be independent. We achieved it and everything was orderly and no problems whatsoever, right? The last of all, about attacking Pakistan, oh, that's a pretty good idea, you know. I'll tell you what, why don't we attack every place that has a Muslim population, you know? The only problem with that is we've got to attack about 40 countries. And you want to know what's the amazing thing is? If you're going to attack places where there are Muslims, we'd have to be attacking the Ukraine as well. So anyhow, I don't know about attacking places. Oh, well, you're more Muslim or this and things like that. They've all had culpability in the terrorism thing in this nature. And I don't think attacking any place is any solution whatsoever. Maybe some good diplomacy through the United Nations and some improve the image of the United States. But anyhow, thanks a lot. Let me know when you got another one in you. Thank you.
Okay, Ileana, go ahead.
I'm going to go beat up a
family. No. I just want to say very quick, like, big influential to Ukraine. It's in Canada. It's one of the biggest Ukrainian communities, you know?
Oh.
And they're the biggest. It's almost like the whole Ukrainian state. That's why probably more about changing in the lifestyle, like it was even like 5 years before in Ukraine. That's what the Canadian Ukrainian community bring to Ukraine, because in Canada it's like capitalism, right? And no more free country, right? But in Ukraine it was used to be socialism and communism, and now, you know, Canadian Ukrainian strong community that influential, like freedom for Ukraine.
Whereabouts in Canada?
What about in Canada? It's like biggest Ukrainian community.
Where?
Like Toronto.
Toronto. How you call it? Toronto.
Saskatchewan or
no, no, Toronto, Montreal. It's biggest, and they constantly going to Ukraine and propose new, you know, lifestyle, like capitalist lifestyle. That's why those Ukrainian people even don't know about capitalism, but they go to Maidan, you know Maidan, and they do opposition to previous government. They wanna be more free, you know, like.
Huh? So they have a bigger, they have big influence.
Right, big influence, yeah, for big influence for the Ukrainian country. No, used to be part of Russia. That's what I want to say.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes.
And a boy, Andy.
hang on a minute, Andy.
Hey, Tim, you are on the clock.
Yes, I've got it here, and no problem at all.
3, 2, 1, start.
I got it.
Great. Try to be
6 minutes, don't worry about it.
As concise as I can. Might only last 2 minutes because I was just dumbfounded there for a while. I didn't know what to say. I'm almost sometimes not really speechless on most things. But I've been wrestling with this for years and years and years. Since I stumbled onto the censored news books about 20 years ago. These books teach how journalism, the media, the billionaires that own the media, how the media in America maintains people. Kind, decent, well, ordinary, college-educated people are maintained in a bubble of ignorance on certain subjects. Where you get outside the United States and people know what's going on. But in America, on certain subjects that are in the best interest of the military-industrial complex or the pharmaceutical-industrial complex or the medical-industrial complex, the billionaires that own and operate the media sit on the same board of directors as the people that own these big billionaire-owned and run companies. On tonight's talk, I'll make a quick comment here. Eric Larson is a professor emeritus from John Jay College of Criminal Justice in New York. He wrote a book in 2011 called The Skull of York. I highly recommend it for anybody that wants to understand why otherwise intelligent, educated people get up in front of a microphone on certain subjects and say the earth is flat. Trust me, basically. The Skull of York, and he's talking about all the Democratic investigative journalists on the left, and he says, why are they not talking about the reality of 9/11? And basically, he comes down to it. He says, people that have a duty to investigate, and they claim to be missing the story, or they can't see evidence that a seventh grader can understand, they're either... Basically, what we're looking at is mind-boggling, terrifying ignorance of a scale that's never been seen before in this country among otherwise educated adults. Either they're just incredibly ignorant, almost like a new infectious strain, or they're lying to us. They're just intentionally lying to us, and they're being paid to lie to us. He uses, that's the first time I heard that term, what quizzling means. From vidcutting quizzling, the Norwegian that collaborated with the Nazis in World War II. But on several key points tonight, Mike Flores promoted pieces of mythology that have no basis in reality. The forensic evidence has been published. It's solid. The first big myth, I'll just talk three of them. The first big myth is that our intelligence agencies were surprised by 9/11. They missed it. Nobody saw it coming. Well, that's just simply not true. The Pentagon knew it was coming and advised their top people not to fly on the night of September 10th. The media was prepared. They had cameras set up to film the planes going into the towers, just a fortuitous event. The media was fully prepared and sold the script to us all day long. Insider trading, Pentagon officials, there's all kinds of information that's been published and hundreds of reports showing that
there are many, many agencies within inside the United States that had insider knowledge that 9/11 was going to happen on 9/11. The second big myth, of course, and this is a huge one, that the World Trade Center was attacked by Muslims. The World Trade Center was a collection of buildings losing money, white elephants. And since 1989, the World Trade Center was scheduled for demolition, but they couldn't figure out how to do it without being sued for contaminating asbestos all over Lower Manhattan. So when the Bush administration began to make rumblings about wanting to take over Iraq and Afghanistan, before they went into the White House, they said, well, let's put our heads together. We got these old buildings, icons that need to be destroyed. Let's call it a terrorist attack. And we'll sell it to the American people as a terrorist attack, and we'll kill two birds with one stone, which is what they did. For anybody that's interested, the Twin Towers in New York were not damaged by the plane crashes in any significant. There's a debate over what kind of planes hit, whether the military pilots think they were drones flying on GPS. But anyway, this physics textbook describes what happened. It's called Where Did the Towers Go? The two twin towers went sideways in the wind as a cloud of dust. They did not collapse to the ground in a big pile of rubble. Hundreds of physicists have done the studies on it. The buildings in New York, the two twin towers were converted to dust in seconds, 5-6 seconds, and they were going sideways in the wind as a cloud of dust, while the girders that have been cut apart with explosives were falling through the dust. Now, that's a piece of forensic evidence that is not debatable in any college where you have physicists. You can have people laughing in groups like this that are just terrifyingly ignorant of the basic facts. That's the term to use. Kind, ordinary Americans are just terrifyingly ignorant of certain facts that are common knowledge all over the world. Mike talked about intelligence agencies. Well, there's hundreds of reports showing that intelligence agencies in other countries, they all knew 9/11 was an inside job on the night of 9/11. They took one look at what was happening on American TV and said Osama bin Laden had nothing to do with that. That was an inside job. The last point I'll make is that Mike says, we don't have a plan. We're not doing good propaganda. Well, our country has a plan. It's called a Project for a New American Century, laid down by Bush Cheney to invade and take over the oil fields of a bunch of different countries. We do really good propaganda in this country so that people can continue to believe that, well, Americans are not responding too good to what these other evil countries are doing. Nothing could be further from the truth. The American military is one giant, well-oiled killing machine. And unless we face that, our country is going to still be going down the tube from the $1 trillion-a-year rat hole. It's $1 trillion a year, about twice as much as the rest of the world spends on defense every year. So we'll be talking about solutions to this on the night of June 7th. For anybody that's interested in joining the reality-based community rather than the fantasy-based community, come pick up some of the literature. We'll have fact sheets. You can look it up yourself. If anybody wants to debate the facts, come prepared on the night of June 7th. Thank you.
You know what this is? It's anthem. It's anthem of the former Soviet Union.
And Russia.
They use the same tool, but the words have changed.
But it's same anthem,
Mike Flores.
Hey guys. Actually, I know the lyrics to the original Communist Party International. Arise, you starvation. Arise, you wretched of the earth. Actually, I know every left and right wing song from the 1920s on. So when I put out a CD, I think one side will be all left wing songs, one side will be all right wing.
Do you know the horse and the
The flag is red with blood of fallen martyrs. I know all these stupid songs. I don't know why.
Mike, all right, I'm going to rebut the anthem. You have to raise your fist.
Let's do some rebuttals here, Pat. Why does our intel constantly lag behind? Well, one thing that's causing it today is our addiction to high tech. Today, we can have a satellite that will show us all sides of the mountains and all the shadows the mountain has. If you look at the world that way, there are constant threats from every direction. Just as we as Americans will line up overnight to get the latest phone that's available. Think about that. We line up overnight to get a phone. Intel agencies want spy satellites. They want all this high-tech crap. How come when George Bush won, Bush won as I call him, left Iraq, we didn't leave a spy ring behind? What the hell were we thinking? We would have known right away whether there were weapons of mass destruction or not if we had left a spy ring there. But no, we don't need that because we have satellite photos. We have high technology. High technology does not replace the man on the ground who can hear what people are saying, can make contacts. That's what we desperately, I believe, need to return to. Now, part of the problem is when you have over 24 intel agencies, and then they all have subgroups, so we're talking about hundreds of intel agencies, how can that be anything but unwieldy? I think the CIA should be involved in propaganda, creating propaganda. Remember, during the Cold War, we used abstract expressionist artwork as a propaganda tool against the Russian artwork, you know, which was like soldiers with their fist in the air looking into the sky.
It's inspiring.
We used abstract expressionism. We used improvisational jazz. The CIA did. What is the CIA doing now?
Twitter.
They're not even using techno music, which is huge in Europe, to draw people to listen to broadcasts. This is just weak. It's just weak. They're not sharing info. There's too many groups. I think only the military should do intel. CIA should create propaganda. I don't know, call me old-fashioned. The State Department has an intel agency? For what? What can the State Department intel agency find that CIA can't find? What is the point of all this? And then they don't share the info. So it's just useless. Now, Mike Foley, you made the comments about Syria. Let's not forget, wasn't Democrats that stopped the invasion of Syria. It was Rand Paul saying the Congress needs to vote on it. Obama discovering that he didn't have the votes and he backed down. It was a libertarian that stopped the attack on Syria, which is still not off the table.
I didn't see him drinking.
Now, as for the old Democratic Party line of Osama bin Laden somehow being connected with the Northern Alliance, who the CIA backed and allowed women in their group and people with, let's just say it's a nice Democratic Party propaganda line. It worked. People who don't know the situation fell for it. Osama bin Laden was worth $7 billion when he was fighting in Afghanistan.
He didn't need our money. What the hell did he need our money for? He wasn't anywhere near the region where we were supplying rockets and missiles. He wasn't even there. One of the things that happened after 1993 and the attack on the World Trade Center, I read all of Osama bin Laden's writings, his poetry, his plays. I had to read all that crap. And I can tell you that he hated CIA then, he hated the West then, he had no use for us. His biggest claim to fame on the battlefield was taking out a Russian tank, and that took about an hour of lobbing grenades and stuff at it. That was his big victory. So the idea that Reagan backed, and by the way, we weren't the only ones that backed the Northern Alliance. Iran did. Iran did not like the fundamentalists that were in Afghanistan, and they actually backed the same group we did, the Northern Alliance. But Osama bin Laden had no use for Westerners. In fact, one interview I read with him that was done in the mid-1990s, a German was interviewing him, and the first thing Osama bin Laden said to him was, "Why haven't I killed you yet?" He had absolutely no love of the West at all at that point. And of course, now we know that the Hancock Center was one of the targets on 9/11 as well, which I think has to do with the fact that he was dating a girl in college who now lives in Chicago, and he wanted to make a big phallic explosion. By the way, 9/11, okay? We are lucky, and this is going to sound horrendous, okay? We are lucky that they chose a Hollywood-style, stupid-ass attack, because our banks were not protected like they are today. If Al-Qaeda had targeted the Chase Bank and the Bank of America, they would have brought our economy down, because we had no way to protect ourselves. If they had taken those two banks, it wouldn't have been a dramatic footage on TV. It wouldn't be like a Hollywood-style attack. They would have destroyed this country. So we're very lucky they chose a Hollywood-style attack and not going after our banking system, which at that time was wide open. There were Russians who were taking out of accounts a nickel here, a nickel there, every day, who were robbing our banks and getting away with it, because the banks had no protection, they had no way to respond. And I know it sounds horrible to say, but we're lucky as a nation that at that point they didn't attack us using computers, because the result would be like in a depression now. I mean, it would be awful. Now, the Taliban was started by Bhutto. And how do we know Bhutto? Because when she came to America, she spoke at feminist conferences all over America raising money. Guess who introduced her twice? A woman by the name of Hillary Clinton introduced her as a fabulous woman leader. She actually gave talks where she said the Taliban was controlled violence, and that as long as Pakistan and as long as there was control on the actions of the Taliban, there was nothing to fear. And there was Hillary cheering them on. Guess what? When you start violence, it can get out of control very quickly, very fast, and that's what happened. But the Taliban was started by Pakistani intel to make excursions into Kashmir and to attack India. In India, they have a cheer that they give when they drink.
They say Cholo Pakistan. That means no more Pakistan. Why we never united with India, I don't know. Instead, we gave billions of dollars to the group that started the Taliban and that has dragged us into the center of this mess. Now, Chuck, you spoke about capitalism. Let me tell you something. There are no regulations on the Russian oligarchs. There is no laws or rules that stop those that have made deals with the Russian government from doing anything they want. And that is not free market capitalism, by the way. I don't think there's a person who believes in free market capitalism on Earth that will defend Blackwater getting sweetheart contracts from Obama and from Bush. I don't think there's a libertarian on Earth that will support the unregulated, unruled Russian capitalist either. The only way out for Russia, the only chance they have, is if the government agrees it will step down, if it is voted out, and if every person in Russia has a chance to enter the capitalist system, to own a store. We're not talking about energy companies. I'm talking about own a dry cleaners, own a local restaurant. Until that is allowed in Russia, then they're doomed.
You want to,
now,
the right to own a dry cleaner?
I would say there is something, however, here. As you know, I am single. And I am an appreciator of women. The three most beautiful women on Earth are Ukrainian women, number one. Google most beautiful women on Earth, and you'll see all over the world, Ukrainian women are number one. Ethiopian women, I put it number two. Swedish women at number three. Gentlemen, we're fighting for something very strong and serious here. But jokes aside, and by the way, I'm dead serious. Ukrainian women are stunning. We have failed in creating propaganda for the Muslim community. We could have easily done TV shows that stated, for example, what it's like to be a Muslim living in America, running a store, what they run into every day, the freedom that they have, without even mentioning it, that the women don't have to wear burqas, that they can know who Lady Gaga is. We could produce a show like that, put it up for downloading, and get it all through the Muslim community. We aren't doing it. We aren't doing anything like that. Our battle, our propaganda battle, is a disaster, Pat. And your question, why is it we always lag behind in propaganda? At this point, I think it's the technology. We're addicted to the technology. You can get a satellite picture that shows you every side of a mountain, but it also shows you all the shadows and doubts. We need people on the ground or we're not going to get anywhere. I don't care where it is. I don't believe tech can replace that. Now, if the CIA, Andy, if the CIA was behind 911,
I didn't say that.
The towers would still be standing. Also, what bothers me about the 911 truthers is that they have lots of reasons for why Bush was responsible, why Bush knew all about it, but they have no explanation why Obama hasn't prosecuted him. Why wouldn't the Democrats, if they had proof, go after him? unless they're in on it too. But no one in the 9-1 truthers ever says Obama is as guilty as Bush.
Oh, yeah.
And if you're not willing to do that, I can't take what you say seriously.
President.
Finally, I'd just like to say thanks for having me here tonight. I hope you guys have had a good time. Remember, I said I'm not giving prophecies. I'm talking about possibilities and about things that we're facing right now. And I'm glad so many of you agree. We're in fucking trouble, thanks.